Hi there, this is Mark. In this video, we're going to take a look at interactive lighting. I can see that in my scene I have this beam of light, and our character is currently darkened to match a night scene. But if the character comes into the light as we scrub, and we preview this, it doesn't quite make sense that it's darkened while underneath the light. We actually want it to go back to normal lighting and have that highlight only when it gets under the light. So what we're going to do is we're going to go down to the background because we know we have this beam shape that we can use. And I can turn this on and off and we'll see the results. So just for fun, I'll add a display with Control Y, Command Y on a Mac, and I will display this. Actually, I'll display it from the source, and let's go to display 3. So you can see we have the beam shape. If I render it, you can see that shape itself again. So we're going to use this to determine where the light source is going to hit. I'm going to switch back to my normal display and I can delete this now. So what I'll do is I'll actually take this strand and I will wire out a second instance of it outside. So the original beam is still going through that blur and going to our composite, then blend mode, but our second strand's going outside. And we'll be able to use this to connect to other things such as inside her treatment. So let's go inside the treatment. And if we look over here, this is where we put our night filter. We can actually rename this if we wanted to night filter. And in our night filter, we have something cutting the night filter, which is her eyes. If you recall, we did a color selector and we chose our eye highlight, eye white and iris. And we said this character is going to be darkened except for where the eyes are showing. Next, what we want to do is we want to say also going to be cutting where that beam is showing because we want her to be bright under the light and then darkened on the outside. So let's add a composite with Control H. And we're going to click here and add that composite so that we can now add a second strand going into our mat for the color scale. The quick way to do that is to grab a node that will have an input. So I usually tend to grab a cutter and I'll just wire something in so that I create this new nub that then will allow me to drag something in such as this shape. So I'll do that. Now that I have that connection happening, I can disconnect and delete that cutter and now I have access to this. So as I said, we want to say wherever the eyes are showing and wherever the beam is showing, I want you to cut away that night filter. And now if we preview this, we can see that the character is much brighter underneath the lamp. If we disconnect this, we see what we used to work with. So now it's nice underneath the lamp. If we go to a frame where she was partially outside, such as here, and we preview that, we can see that she's getting lit underneath the beam, but not outside the beam. Now this looks a little weird, and the way light would work, it would actually hit beyond the edges onto the character. It would kind of ripple off. So let's do a little bit of a change here. I'm going to go back out, and I'm going to go in here, and instead of wiring straight down, I will actually add a matte resize to expand that matte, and so we can blur it. So if we go to our filter, let's grab a matte resize module. And what a matte resize does is it essentially takes the shape and we will either expand or contract that shape to either take more room or less room. And in this case, I want it to take more room. So I'll click that matte resize and I'll give it a radius of 10. And if we look at our render view, it's going to expand the way that this beam works. Now it takes a little longer to calculate matte resizing on bitmap layer, but there you go. You have the beam and then it's coming down further out because we pushed it out. We could also have taken a peg transform to scale up this shape and physically move it away, but I find this works quite nicely. And then what we want to do is we want to add a little blur to this shape because it's a little harsh over here, right? So what we want to do is go into our blur in filter, and we're going to grab a blur radial here, and we're going to plug that in. Again, there's no change over here because there needs to be some sort of number in here to make it modified. What we're going to do is we're going to turn off that truck factor and let's give it a subtle blur. So I think I'll go with a 3 here. See what that looks like once it renders. So that looks nice. It's a subtle offset and it blurs. So when she gets into the light, she comes outside of the darkness and into the light. Now we can still see the highlight outside, so we need to go and remedy this. So let's go back outside and back into our treatment group. Okay, what we want to do next is actually a bit of a tricky situation. So we already have the highlight reversed and all the operations we did. What we actually want to do is reverse it. So instead of saying take everything but, we want to actually tell the highlight what it is. So let's just disconnect this and reverse the highlight. And to explain this, what I'm going to do is I'll move this to the side and I'll use a cutter and take the original character and cut it by the offset. So if I add a display just to explain what that does, and let's switch back to this, I'm literally saying take that character, drop it down, and that's what's going to cut it. So I've got the same character and that's leaving just the sliver around. If I look at my matte view, you see this is exactly what's left, is just the sliver of information. So we'll switch back to your regular displays. And now that we have this, we're basically saying, okay, we'll use that information to tell the highlight where to highlight. And there we go, we have that start. And let's delete that display. So now I know I want to show the character offset giving me that sliver. And I also don't want it to show down here. So I also want to cut that operation with the gradient that we had before. So let's just do that. And we're wiring it in here. So as you can see, as I did that, we lost the shoe highlight because we're saying this character will be cut by its offset and also by this gradient shape, which gives us the revealing matte. Now the last step is we can also use another cutter in here and say, okay, this shape, we're going to only allow it inside this beam. And now it's cut outside the beam. There's only a highlight on the inside. If we scrub through, we'll see that the highlight is hitting on the inside along with the matte blur. So it matte resizing outside and, this is exactly what we want. Just to clarify that one more time, I'll add a display and let's break it down. So display 3 is saying this is our offset. So we're adding the character and then we're adding the gradient to it. We're saying this is going to hide the original character, which is this. So then, since that character is being cut by these shapes, we get this result. So it's basically the highlight and a faded off ramp. And then I'm saying only show it inside the beam. So it's fading off inside the beam only. And so we have the resulting highlight only inside the beam. And now we'll go back to our regular display. I'll delete this. And now that we have our character's interactive lighting set up, we need to also make sure that the puddles are getting hit with the proper color. So I like to copy existing night filters to props and effects. So we can see that we have this water, and the water and the effects are also outside at night. So we're going to want to copy this, Control C or Command C on a Mac. And outside, we're going to Control V or Command V on a Mac. And we'll place that underneath. And let's call this night filter prop. And the reason I do that is I don't want the props or the water in this case to be as dark. So I'll move these values back up on 0.9 on the red, 0.8 on the green, and let's go 0.9 on the value as well. And let's copy that over here because we also have a puddle that we want to have darkened. Now, let's go back inside that background And we can see that we have not only the beam here that can affect our character, but we also have this circular shape that we want to make sure catches light. So we want to make sure when the splash is inside here that it lights up, and when it's outside that it darkens. So I'm going to create a new composite, Control H, Command H on the Mac. And I already have the beam, which I've resized and blurred, which is what I'd like to keep. And this is the floor lamp, so I'll wire this down. And so now if I take a look at that display, I can see that I have this mat. So it's going to be using the shape of the beam and the floor light down here to control what is lit and what isn't. Now let's get back to our regular display, and I'll delete that one. And we're going to wire this composite out to affect our outside layers. So I'll just wire it down to the middle port here. And in here, I can click and drag to my puddles. And on the outside left of my night filter, I get the integrated port, which lights up my filter. So let's just take a look real quick at our puddles. Okay. So if I didn't have this matte ported, you could see that the water would darken, but because I clicked it on, it says whatever is inside these shapes will be light. So I'll do the exact same thing. I'll wire this over to my night filter for the water, and I can see there's a bit of an issue here. So what we could also do is simply draw a shape to fill the entire cone. So maybe let's do that instead. Let's do that. I'm going to add a composite. And let's wire this over here. Again, we're going to wire that back and create a new drawing for shape. And over here, we'll just fill out the basic beam that we want to retain colors in. I'll use my polyline tool and I'll just draw this over here. Since the bottom oval is completely full, I don't have to worry too much down here, so I'll just draw around it. And if I go to my camera view, the shape has completed itself, and I just have to delete that line so I have a single shape. And again, since we drew on one frame here, we want to make sure that it lasts the entire time. Lastly, I want to make sure there's a blur so that, let's get out of OpenGL, back to OpenGL here. When it hits the water like that, I don't want a hard edge like this. I want a blurry edge. So I'll grab the blur radial, turn off truck factor, and let's make this a 6. Now I have a subtle fade, so it'll be lit inside of the cone and it'll be darkened outside the cone to create a nice interactive lighting here for our whole setup.